Welcome everyone. We are going to get into it in this video, just like I got into it this morning, in great depth of clarity about this very, very, very intense issue that simply does not go away. And I know many people say that talking about negative events in the world means you're not spiritual. Well, if that's the case, then Jesus wasn't. Take a look at Jesus. I mean, he put an extreme emphasis on preparation, preparation. There's going to be a terrible calamity in this world at the end of this cycle. Coming like a thief in the night. If days weren't cut short, not a single living thing would be left on this planet. I mean, he put such immense emphasis on that we need to prepare for the world that is to come and not this world. And there's trouble in this world. He warned the people back then of Jerusalem, the fall of Jerusalem. So he warned us about what is to come. So if doing that is, it means you're not spiritual, then those who say that, they're saying Jesus is not spiritual at all. He's the least spirit. They would, from their own logic, he would be like the least spiritual being there is, having warned us about severely negative events. But what I found in digging into this this morning in tremendous depth, it's just the opposite. It's just the opposite. Because in warning us about such things, and taking a look at why would this something like this happen, we unravel the ego. We unravel the ego. We see its strategy. We see what the sickness is we're suffering from. We see the trouble. It's actually a very, very helpful thing to warn people, to warn us here. Now, here's something that, I've lived this my whole life, so I know what I'm talking about. The spiritual gift, one of the gifts I had was precognition. I was extraordinarily gifted with precognition. I knew it was going to happen, constantly what was going to happen. Just knew. And I would tell people this, and it happened. It was just effortless on my part. But there was tremendous backlash over this, and I found out that people hated this. They really started hating me and shunning me and avoiding me, and I felt like, oh my gosh, I got to get rid of this. If I'm, I don't want to be ostracized. So I tried to sort of get rid of this capability, and it's just been a terrible curse actually to be aware of what's coming. But I knew from the beginning of my life, prior to that even, I was aware that there's likely to be space rocks come in, hit the world. Absolutely, this is in fact the most basic warning that I was trying to give. There is going to come a time where there's going to be big trouble, and nobody wants to hear it. So you become a persona non grata. It's quite extraordinary, terrible. But what I found out was that people don't want to hear it, and so I dug into this again this morning, and I understood to extraordinary extent what's really going on here in the world. I don't know if I can explain it all the clarity of the insight, but it was certainly there, and it is there to be seen, I'll tell you that. It is there to be seen. It has to do with the ego and our trusting in the ego and our desire for the ego to succeed. And our desire to be blessed by the ego. We feel that we're failing and we need a blessing from the ego. And the ego promises us a great blessing. Now remember, our goal is to create a new reality. And the new reality that the ego advises us is to ignore reality. And that ignoring of reality is the new reality. So the ego is trying to help us ignore reality, but we're having a very difficult time with that. Of course, it's impossible. Reality still exists, it's still real, and we are part of reality. We are one with reality. So we have to defend against this, and we use perception to do so. So the battle between the ego and the Holy Spirit is over perception, actually. And the Holy Spirit has a way to shift our perspective, our perceptual perspective, such that we experience, have a different experience that infers that reality is still real. Where what the ego wants to do is to prevent that shift in perspective, perceptual perspective, so that we keep inferring that reality is not real. Now, part of it is, according to Jesus, that you start seeing light around everything, which is, it's like everything has this non-definitional dance around it. So the dance, the play of light that we can see around everything reassures us that light has not been defined. And yet it lets us have a staging with the familiar props that were nature or props that we're used to. And yet we're being reassured that light has not been defined. What we tried to do is define what we are, which is impossible. We can't define light as something, because light is in the service of all that is and experiencing. Just like pure spaciousness, all reality is in service of all reality, and it's freedom. So you cannot say, well, the light is this tree. No, light is always just the light. It never crystallizes. So our perception now infers plausible inference that everything is crystallized. Light is crystallized. We've managed to define light in many different ways. Where what the vision of Christ, what the Holy Spirit has for us is, we're able to see this play of light, which shows that it's free, and it's not defined, even though it's willing to associate, show us it's still associating with the familiar forms. But it says, look, I'm not really crystallized, and so it does this dance so that it seems there's an inference, it's inferring that it's not crystallized. There's a plausible inference it's not crystallized. Now the ego doesn't want us to have this vision and experiencing this. It does not. Its goal is to prevent this. It's to prevent it. So this is sort of setting up the situation right now. It wants to keep us inferring that reality is not real anymore, that it's been defined, and light is no longer light. It's now matter, crystallized matter form. So those who are really, really loyal to the ego, that's what they want. They want to not see the light and keep believing that and keep this plausible inference that reality is no longer real, that we've changed it and this is the new reality. Now there's a huge influx into this world of those who are loyal to the ego, very loyal, very, very loyal. And those who are loyal to the Holy Spirit, they seem to be, their numbers are dwindling very rapidly here, very severely. Now, those who are loyal to the ego, they say, help ego, help, help, help. We're still attracted to something that we feel that threatens our belief on crystallization of light, and you need to help us with that and prevent us from falling into any experience that shows otherwise. And so they're calling for a great blessing from the ego, and the ego reassures them there'll be a great blessing which will solidify your position and convince you that it's right. So there's so many have come into this world who are really severe egotists, so severely loyal to the ego. This is my observation. The newer generations are that way to a large extent. There are exceptions, of course, quite a few, but we're just talking about in general terms here. And so they want this blessing, and they're here in this world, they believe they're going to receive this great blessing from the ego. That's why they're here. That's why they're here. Now, what could this great blessing be? Well, there's a twist to it all, because the ego tells them, has told them, that it has to be a surprise. You can't, it's like a Santa telling the kids, hey, you don't open the presents. The parents telling him that Santa brought, don't open it. Well, of course, Santa doesn't leave presents until Christmas morning, but don't open the presents. It's got to be a surprise until Christmas. So the kids have to go, I want to find out, what is it? And they say, no, if you open it, the parents say, if you open it, it'll turn to ashes. They scare the child, saying, yeah, the present will turn to ashes on you if you open it early. So what the ego has done is told those who are loyal to the ego that if we know what the surprise blessing is, what the blessing is, if we know ahead of time, it will ruin the blessing. It will, then the blessing will turn into a curse. This is what the ego tells everyone who will listen to it. So those who are expecting a blessing from the ego, they are adamant about not knowing about it ahead of time. They feel this will turn into a curse for them, and it'll be ineffective. So they insist on being distracted. They insist upon being distracted. And we have this situation in the world now where almost everyone in the world is so distracted, it's just extraordinary how distracted they are. And we could draw the wrong conclusion from that, saying, well, nothing's going to happen. No, they are preparing for a blessing from the ego. This is how they prepare, that they don't want to run the risk of finding out about it ahead of time. So they do everything possible to keep themselves distracted from it. Which is why spiritual clarity is dying out in this world. This is why. Now, this great blessing that the ego has, which is going to come as a surprise upon the world, at least to the egotists. I know what it is. Holy Spirit knows what it is. Jesus knows what it is already. But much of the world wants it to be a surprise. Okay, so this is very, very important. This is what I discovered. Why people didn't want to know about what was going to happen. I said, I could have told you that this was going to happen. I still do this all the time. I said, look, I told you this was going to happen, and it did. Why did you listen? No, it's got to be a surprise. See, they believe that imperilment is a blessing. Imperilment of the body is a blessing. They believe that somehow this provides a change in some sort of special will to spirit, which enables spirit to then change reality. So when you tell them that something bad's going to happen, or warn them, they're very upset because they say, well, no, that was the blessing the ego was going to give to me. Now you've ruined it. This is literally what happens. This is literally the religion of this world, the egoic religion of this world. It's just like this. I've experienced it my entire life. People do not want to know ahead of time. They think it's a benediction to suffer, to be assaulted, to have all these issues, arise for them. They say, oh yes, the ego, thank you so much. This will bless me because it distracts me away from the Holy Spirit. Now, the people who come here, the egotists have come to this world, they have been promised the ego is going to give them the greatest blessing ever. And so they are absolutely primed for that, very much primed through their severe distraction, and they're insisting upon it. This is, they said, we need it, because once we get this, we'll be able to turn away from God forever. They think, turn away from the light forever. Well, so what is this blessing? What's the surprise? I know the surprise, but nobody's really listening. This is the trouble. You could warn, you could stand up the rooftops and warn everybody, and very few will pay any attention. They say, no, we're not supposed to know what's going to happen because that will ruin it for us. Well, it's the asteroids. It's the asteroids. It's space rocks coming in, hitting this planet, and the resultant troubles that arises from this, including massive dust and vapor, and on and on and on and on and on. The ego thinks that's the ultimate blessing. Why? Because it thinks that the symbol of dust everywhere, not being able to see light anywhere, is a powerful metaphor for not being able to see the light that the shifted perception will show us. And so the ego believes that this is the way to drag us down into darkness, so we will not even imagine that we could see this light, beautiful light on everything, because the world will look so dark and so ugly and so hideous that we'd just be freaked out about it. And so this freak out is what the ego's great blessing is upon those who are egotists, who are loyal to the ego. This is what is going down here in this world. And I've known this my whole life, but you know, how do you explain the religion of the ego is so weird. It's taken a lifetime to recognize what's going on, really. But they're here. Those who want this are here. They think it's a benediction. They think it's a blessing. They say, this is awesome. You know, we're experiencing this extreme darkness and imperilment and suffering and misery, and this is really going to leave such a huge impression upon us. We'll never turn to that the light that seems to be tempting us. We'll finally be immune to it. This is what they hope. And you just, you know, hearing this, you just say, wow. Is this possible? Well, for my living my lifetime, I say absolutely it's possible. I have seen so many things I knew was going to happen, and I tried to warn people. They didn't, nobody paid attention. Like the Boxing Day tsunami, and it was a day after Christmas. I knew about that a year in advance. Absolutely knew about a year in advance. I dreamed the whole thing. I experienced the whole thing in a dream. I tried for a year to warn people. Nobody, not even one person, paid any attention to it, really. They don't want to know. I knew about 9/11 in advance, about 6 months in advance. I didn't know exactly, you know, like it was so weird. It's like, what is this? I knew this would be the terrible, terrible catastrophe that's going to change society, involving airplanes smashing into buildings and such. But it was just such a weird thing. I couldn't really relate to it. The tsunami was a little easier to relate. I said, oh, this is a huge earthquake and a tsunami. So I was able to pinpoint what that was. I even pinpointed the intensity of the earthquake. I wasn't exactly sure where it was going to be in the globe. So I didn't have all the details. But this is normal for me. I'm aware, I've always been aware of what's going to happen, but nobody will listen to you. Nobody will listen. What a life, huh? Cassandra, you know, is that the life of Cassandra? Nobody pays attention. So, but this asteroid problem is been one that has been with me my whole life, knowing it's going to happen, and it's, you know, when soon. I don't know exactly when. I didn't get exact dates in the dreams necessarily, but certainly in a relatively short time frame, you would say. I hope it's delayed as much as possible, or delayed entirely, you might say, if we could change our perspective. Now, one way to do that is for people to realize it is coming, and then the egotist will say, forget it, you ruined it. It's ruined for us, so we don't want it. We don't want it. There'll be a curse now. You know, so that would actually stop it. I know science doesn't believe that, but it's true that we are the sovereigns over our own experiencing completely, the mind. So this is why sometimes predictions, the prophets say, hey, this is going to happen, if you don't repent. Meaning, if you realize this is what you're trying to bring upon yourselves and decide you don't really want it and become aware of it, and then say, that ruins it, it won't necessarily happen. And that doesn't make the prophet wrong. The purpose of pointing out prophecy partly is so people will repent and change their mind, and so it doesn't happen. Now, I don't see that happening in this world. They really don't. Anyone who talks about asteroid hitting the world, people say, well, they're nuts, and then just ignore them. They do this because they want it to be a surprise. They want to be surprised. They feel that's a very important element. The ego's told them and told everyone who listened that surprise is all important. Why? Well, if you knew if something like that was coming, you would sidestep it. You'd find a way. You'd say, let's get out of here. Right? And so you wouldn't suffer. So the ego doesn't want that. That's why it says it's got to be a surprise. You don't take any measures to stop it or avoid it. That's why. People think, oh, no, it'll be a benediction to us. No, if we really knew it was coming, we'd say, I don't really want that. Forget it. That's why the ego says it needs to be a surprise. You can't know what's coming. Because it's so terrible. You wouldn't want it. That's why. You see it. You say, "Oh, of course, of course." That's a, what else can the ego do? Hey, don't tell anybody. Don't. I can't let you know what's coming. No, be place to play down, play stupid. Don't tell anybody. It'll ruin it. It'll ruin the effectiveness. Yeah, well, it'll certainly, if we sidestep it, it will have no effect. You know, there's no effectiveness to it really at all, other than delay. Now, if we sidestep it, there won't be that delay based on that, of course. That's great. Let's sidestep it by all means. So, this is the gist of it. This is the gist of it. And by looking at it, we can say, I don't really want that. That's ridiculous. And I see it's just a direct attempt to divert us from the Holy Spirit. And yet there's so many in the world that that's what, exactly what they want. That's what they think they really want. Now, they're going to have buyer's remorse, a lot of them. But, you know, not necessarily all of them. I mean, it's amazing the kind of troubles we put ourselves through in this dream of flesh. And people, we keep believing it's a benediction. So, oh, this is a great benediction. This is really going to be very helpful. And this is necessary for the you know, the new reality to be born. We've had massive, you know, sacrifices throughout history, and genocides and pogroms and wars, and, you know, just all sorts of sacrificing the flesh taking place in belief that this is going to, is a great blessing for us that will result in future happiness, kind of thing. Well, the one that's coming, Jesus said, the one that's coming now is a real doozy. It's a big time one. Now, for those who want to see the light, you know, this is not helpful at all for us. Not at all. We don't see it as a blessing or a benediction in any way. So we could say, no. No thanks. Thanks, but no thanks. Had another dream where went into this hotel, went up several floors, and went into that floor, and my gosh, the opulence and just the workmanship and the materials were just so extraordinarily well done, and it just was just amazing, the richness of that floor of the hotel. But I found there was all these rich old ladies living in this hotel who were being catered to and taken care of, assisted living, and I was expected to help out with that. Remember, the lady was dressed in black and red. This lady's dressed in black and red, and she was supposed to, we were supposed to like listen to her talk and be nice to her. I was saying, well, yeah, the hotel's like really beautiful, this floor, but I really don't want to do this. I think it's kind of like they tried to make this hotel look so beautiful so you'd feel like that you'd like to stick around and listen to them talk. They were senile, all like dementia. Yeah, I don't really want to sit around and listen to old demented ladies suffering from dementia. I think I got something I really want. But again, the opulence and the workmanship and just all the subtle baroqueness of the trim and the baseboard and the floor, the material, the workmanship, boy, it was just reeked of super wealth. But I said, I believe I want to take the elevator up and go up to the higher floor, I believe. And then I had this sort of vision, imaginary vision, of what would the higher floor look like? Oh my gosh, it was beautiful. Things were like semi-transparent with beautiful light everywhere. And it was just so spacious, and it just put this place to shame where I was. The floor I was on now just put it to absolute shame. I said, wow, that's where I want to go. I would feel way more at home up there. And there was no dementia up there at all. So it's just if you think of something just built with diamonds and it was more beautiful than that. It was just the most beautiful gems and light and everything. It was even more beautiful. It's almost ephemeral and sublime with this beautiful light and what a room, what a floor that was of the hotel. So I said, you know what? That's where I'm going to go. That's where I'm going to go. But do not underestimate the faith in the ego that most people have, and how the ego blesses those who have faith in it is through death, but more than death, imperilment, severe darkness, severe disturbance, that which seems to cut us off from the light. This is what the biggest blessings the ego has, is these asteroids hitting the planet and causing the light to be blotted out from the sun for a long time. And there's this incredible amount of dust and just unbelievable suffering. The ego sees that as the greatest benediction possible, the greatest help to us possible. So that's the ace it has up its sleeve. And we're told that it's going to play that card at the end of this world cycle. And we're here at the end of the world cycle. There's no question about that. And so the Holy Spirit has pointed out to me in no uncertain terms over and over and over and over that this is going to happen. Or at least this is where we're headed if we don't repent. And the Holy Spirit seems to say that not enough have repented. I mean, it's going to happen. Get ready, it's coming, it's coming, it's coming, it's coming. That's what the ego will deliver. That's what the egotists are asking. They're asking the ego for the ultimate blessing. They don't know what it is yet because they're playing, you know, they've got to be surprised by it. But for the ego, that is the ultimate blessing, the maximum imperilment, maximum distraction from the light. Produce something on stage, this stage here, which truly distracts us from the light in a severely traumatic way. That's its greatest blessing for us, other than just total ultimate confusion, mental confusion. But this will reach close to that, and the agony, you know, is off the charts. So we don't want that. We certainly don't want it. Go up to the higher floor. Now, the Holy Spirit keeps doing miracles for me. I kept saying, what do I do? It says you need to start jumping. So I've been jumping, a lot of jump rope, a lot of jumping up on steps and jumping down. Like a porch step, you can jump up, jump down, jump up, jump down, jump up, jump down. Get ready to jump up. And so today, there's this truck, and I get out of my vehicle, and something slides off the roof of the truck and lands it right at my feet. And it's a huge bundle of rope. I said, oh my gosh. I picked it up and gave it to the guy. He says, ah, thank you so much. And I said, well, thank you. I said, well, rope, jump rope, a lot of rope. Or it could mean a lifeline, too. Someone's going to throw me a lifeline, big-time lifeline. Then later on in the day, someone says, roll down your window, and someone says, has a whole bundle of rope. He says, here, take this rope. Same day. I was like, wow. Same type of rope, thickness of rope, too. I said, holy cow, what is going on here? So I've been doing a lot of jump rope, for sure. And but also wondering, is it not, you know, a lifeline that we're being given, this very strong lifeline, this very strong rope, can really pull a tremendous amount of weight. So I keep doing what I can do to out the ego. And again, most people will not listen. They want it to be a surprise. They think this will ruin the effect, the help that it has to bring. And of course, it's not help. It's just delay. It's just delay, more delay. That's not what we really want. That's not help. Ultimately, we have to, of course, evaporate our continuity fear and realize that truth is still true. Hasn't changed at all. We can't change it. And we have to go through this intermediate step of plausible inference that this, the truth, is still true, which is still perception. So delaying, just all, what does it do? It just delays the inevitable, that's all. Just delays the inevitable. It's just stupid. It's just useless delay, actually. So it'd be great to get a lifeline here. I feel a lifeline is coming in some way. Powerful indications it is. I'm willing to speak up. I'd be a hypocrite if I didn't speak up on this, because really, I've tried to just get away from it because I say, what's the use, really? But the Holy Spirit keeps bringing up these miracles of recognition, foreshadowing, that are just so extraordinary that it's just like a flurry of these. And I'm not looking for them. I'm not welcome. I just say, gosh, wow. again, really, again. And there's always very adamant and forceful, like, this, you know, this is coming, get ready, this is important, pay attention. And I say, well, okay, but tell us how to sidestep it too. It's no good to, well, it's helpful to know about it, to recognize the ego. Why is it happening? This is an important step to sidestepping, is recognizing, why is it happening? You think, well, maybe it's important, maybe I need to experience this. No, it's not important. We don't need to experience it. It's trying to, again, distract us away from the vision of light that the Holy Spirit has for us, which gives us plausible inference that reality is still real, that light has not been defined. If light's been defined, then we feel we're trapped in this material dream of universe, right? Then reality's no longer real. We have to work with electromagnetism and form and all this, if light has been defined. But what the vision of the Holy Spirit's vision of light shows us is that light has not been defined. It shows us, that light shows us, no, we honor your creativity. Light's honoring our creativity, but it's showing us it has never crystallized at all. It has not crystallized. And this higher floor in the hotel, you're able to see this very clearly, is that light really has not crystallized. And of course, why do we get dementia? Why do we get all these problems? So this all comes as a surprise. We're playing dumb. We're playing dumb. And some people really take it to quite an extreme. They don't want to know what the ego is going to do. They want to be surprised. They think, oh, I had no idea. I used to know everything that was going to happen, and was not surprised by anything that happened, really. I knew that was going to happen, of course. And it was like, and you just get out of the way. You see, it's coming, get out of the way. I still do that to some extent, but the pressure to drop all that has been very strong. So again, just because the world rejects this and doesn't pay attention doesn't mean it's not going to happen. In fact, yeah, that's a pretty strong indication that something's likely to happen, the way they react to it, because they say, don't tell me, I don't want to know. I don't want to know. I want it to be a surprise. And the influx of those in this world who want this experience is just extraordinary influx, which again indicates the likelihood this will happen here. That's why they came here. So because this is going to happen here, and this is, so they attracted them. It attracted them into this world here. They feel this is going to be the ultimate blessing. Out of this will come a new reality, and they will dwell in the new reality. They won't have to deal with the continuity fear at all. They don't have to repent at all. They feel that they'll be the new prime creator. So it's an arrogant, whimsical, silly notion that they're still being driven by continuity fear. So they feel that they need this great egoic blessing in order for this to happen for them, so they won't have to repent. Because they feel that they're not good at repenting. Well, you know, who is good at repenting? It's something you have to work at. The more you repent, the better you get at it. You don't start out really good at repenting. You start out desperate and say, okay, I'll try. And again, people hate to hear that. They think, oh, you're a fearmonger, you're a lunatic, you're this, you're this, you're this. And so I've lived under this cloud my whole life. It's a terrible cloud to live under. But I'm feeling better now because I understand the madness of it, of these those who want this to happen. It's not me that wants it to happen. It's the egotists that want it to happen. But they want it to be a surprise, and nobody knows about it. So of course NASA is going to say, we don't see a thing, we have no idea, or the Vatican or whoever. The elites say we don't know, but at the same time they're building all these underground massive underground living situations, dwelling situations, and they're claiming they don't know anything about it. Well, okay. But, you know, they may have an inkling. They say, oh, let's hedge our bets. We got the money to hedge our bets. But they want it to be potent. They think they need potent medicine to offset the Holy Spirit, because they feel the Holy Spirit has been creeping up on them, and they're getting more and more attracted to what it has to offer. They say, "Oh my gosh, this is terrible." They think, "Oh, this will not ruin me, annihilate me. God will be finally get a hold of me and will extinguish me because I tried to change what God is and all this nonsense." And the continuity fear is so extreme. It projects itself in all sorts of plausible inference ways that are false, and yet it still seems like a conglomeration of massive fear and dread and terror, and oh, I don't dare do this. I know, I've been through it all, but so now I understand it, I recognize it, and say, wow, this is what everyone's up against here. No wonder why they don't pay attention. They think they need this blessing from the ego is the only way, and so they don't want to, they don't want to sidestep it. They think they'll miss out. They think, well, then I'll be just stuck in this inability to repent, and they'll be hideous. Well, actually, everybody can repent. We all have the will to do it. You just start out slow and just get, you know, gain momentum, gain more and more momentum. So I'm very interested to take one day at a time here and do what I can, see what develops. I don't want curiosity to kill the cat. I don't want to try to be too curious, but again, going back to Jesus, if saying that, pointing this out, is it means that you're bad, bad, bad. Well, that's what Jesus did more than anybody. Pointed out some terrible circumstances to come here, terrible situation that'll come upon the world at a time when he said an evil, very bad generation will arise, and people then will be very much backslid into paganism and to the egoic belief and trusting in the ego. And it'll be so bad that even those who are choosing God are in danger of being pulled back into loyalty to the ego. That's how bad it will be, he says, the worst ever. Super darkness, and then the terrible, some sort of terrible cataclysm that will, you know, that will just cause the most severe tribulation ever. Hey, warn us, and say, get ready. And the attitude is it'll come like a thief in the night, well, because everybody here, almost everyone here wants it to be a surprise. But to those who are willing to go for the Holy Spirit's way, of course we have awareness of that it's coming at some point here. It's only those who want to be surprised by the thief or aren't aware. The mind is one. All intentions are known. So we can certainly know there's the intention of a thief wanting to come and take measures to avoid that. Absolutely we can. But the egotists say, no, nobody can know. It's impossible to know. There's no way to deal with it. They want to be surprised. The ego told them surprise is absolutely essential. Because otherwise they'd say, holy cow, this is more than we want. This is too much. Forget it. Ego, you're crazy. They'd turn against the ego if they saw what is coming, probably. So the ego, of course the ego tells them it's got to be a surprise. How are we doing here? Cold night. It's creeping into me. It's another gorgeous, clear winter. Well, it's not winter yet. By the way, I love the winter solstice. Why? Because from that moment on, the days are getting longer, and there's more light. Every day there's more light. I love it. Very optimistic. It's the worst day and the best day. It's the worst day because there's the least light, and the best day because from here on, more and more and more and more and more and more light until it, you know, peaks in June 21st, right? Longest day of the year. It's like, wow, love it. More light, the better. So we're getting close, only 6 days away, and from that point, we're pivoting towards more light. So again, I found that looking at all this very clearly and pragmatically, just looking at what's happening, I found it to be very helpful, very, very, very helpful. And it explained a lot. It explained so much of what's going on in this world, so much, much that other, I mean, the other spiritual teachings have not explained it to my satisfaction at all. Because of my experience in this world has been such I see this as paramount. You can't warn people about anything. You can't tell them this is going to happen. They won't listen. In fact, they hate you. They persecute you if you do. And I said, well, why are people so crazy here? And now I know. They really are this way. It's not something that I'm making up. It's something I've directly experienced my entire life here. They really are that way. This is the way of this world. What a place. What a terrible place. Indeed. So don't let these rich old bags dictate to us that we're supposed to hang around in humor their dementia. I mean, the whole planet is a planet dementia here, really. Tell you the truth. It's, they certainly conflate everything. They confuse, and you know, what is different. They think what is different is the same. What is same is different. I mean, it's a spiritual dementia here on this planet. Severe spiritual dementia here. I'm not going to humor them just because they try to throw some scraps our way of wealth, so to speak, because the higher level is you see the light, you experience it, it's so much better, so much better. So, just getting this out here to the world, and be reassured, this is not a sign, oh, he's gone crazy, or this, not at all. Seeing it more and more and more clearly, the overall dynamic certainly of this planet, and this leads to overall understanding of the universe too, that the way the ego works and the goal is it's distraction and delay, distraction and delay, distraction and delay. That's it. What else can the ego do? That's its business, distraction and delay. And so, of course, it's a stock in trade. And so seeing a stock in trade and seeing the loyalty people have because of continuity fear, then you're able to heed the warnings of the prophets and recognize that they're not crazy. And I've certainly dreamed about this happening in this world. Not in a completely direct way about all the direct dynamics, not quite as much as the tsunami. But certainly the rocks, the dust, and all of that, absolutely I have. And the devastation on the planet, seeing it, it was horrible. The dust, and there's a thick fog vapor, just dark, 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 cold, dark, like a nuclear winter is almost. It's worse than that. And the people just, you know, just are like just utterly stunned, everybody walking around in complete shock. And I've lived through it in dreams, and just saying, wow, you know, let's go up to a higher floor here. So, if we can practice the idea of going up to a higher floor, jumping up to this higher floor, even, and you know, I'm jumping rope, which is quite extraordinary. Before I didn't think I could even do it, and now I'm knocking out sets of 50. And getting more and more and more springy, more and more springy, which sort of mirrors the attitude of let's spring into a higher level here, higher floor of this hotel perception. And I know that we're welcome there. I can speak for everyone, is anyone who wants to, who's willing to go there, they're more than welcome. More than welcome. Hospitality is extraordinary. Now, when you get to experience a higher realm of a light, just start with the wow. Say wow, okay? And don't think you have to explain it or just get off the elevator. Just say, okay, I'm going to sit down here for a while. Just wow, I'm just going to settle into this gradually. Don't have to put it in words. Don't try to put it in words. When you experience these little jumps up, jump up, jump up, don't put it in words. Don't try to put that in words, as far as descriptive. As far as, you know, trying to be clearly descriptive, you might just say, well, it's nice light. But I'm not describing exactly what I saw so much. You cannot, really. It's ineffable. It's beyond description, really. Pretty much so, and don't try to describe it because that's trying to crystallize it, define it. It defies definition, really. That's the whole point of it. It infers that light is, can never be defined or crystallized. It gives this inference. This is the impression. That's the purpose of it. So indeed, it does give this impression. That's all you need to say. All needs to be said, pretty much so. So I'm trying to make videos with some graphics that try to convey going up to a higher level, more beautiful level. And we get used to that. That's a little bit helpful. Absolutely, it is better than struggling with the dementia of this world. Wouldn't we say, forget about the dementia of this world. Don't struggle with it. It's intentional dementia to insist on being surprised. It's a willful. It's a strategy. So once you see the strategy, then you stop struggling so much with the world. This is the benefit of it. See, this is why I'm saying this is very beneficial to see this. You realize, oh my gosh, it's intentional that they believe that by being surprised by this, and I mean, therefore not avoiding it, they're going to get this great ultimate blessing from the ego. But we know it's just delay, distraction, delay, which is no blessing at all, actually. Makes a mockery of the meaning of blessing. So it's intentional. These old ritual bags with dementia, so to speak, this world, it's intentional. It's an act. So you're not going to get anywhere with them. I've never gotten anywhere with the world trying to really teach it anything. It's intentional. They don't want to because they think this great blessing is coming from the ego. That's why the spiritual willingness to listen, spiritual truth is dying out on this planet because they think this great blessing is coming. And so they say, we don't want to risk missing this great blessing. So the ego tells us, don't listen to this stuff. So we're not going to listen to it. We're just going to block it out. So they're just blocking it out. So you're not going to get anywhere with this dementia in the world, this spiritual dementia. Not going to get anywhere right now. But by knowing all this, although they'll say, hey, you know, I think I've had enough of the ego. And then they'll stop pretending to be stupid. And then they'll start listening and you'll realize, hey, they're not stupid. They're just pretending to be dumb, playing dumb. But as long as they're willing to play dumb, there's nothing anyone can do. Nothing anyone can do, really. Let the Holy Spirit do whatever can be done, which is beyond our understanding, actually. So I don't, maybe the Holy Spirit can do something, help them, yeah, but as far as from our perspective, from our perceptual perspective, which is where we're from, plausible inference from where we're coming from now because of continuity fear, this issue, we can't see what can be done, not really. It's a waste of our time. Put our focus on the higher levels of light, which is inferring that light has never been crystallized, can never be crystallized. That gives a plausible inference. Put our attention on this higher realm, more beautiful, and the living light. seeing the living light, the dance of it, along with still form, still something perceptual form, but it seems more transparent and diaphanous, and you could still recognize that there seems to be form here. You don't feel uncomfortable with it. Just put our attention on that and say, I need to get used to this. I need to get familiar with this. Don't struggle anymore with the world, which is why Holy Spirit told me, stop the news now. Stop. And I did. I stopped cold turkey. Haven't gone back to it. I don't know what's going on in the world, really. You hear, faint things through the grapevine of whispers of, oh, something, another shooting. Well, the Holy Spirit told me there'd be one every day, basically. So don't pay any attention to any of that stuff. But the foreshadowing of the asteroid thing is pretty interesting. 9/11 was certainly a foreshadowing of it. All the dust cloud, the Twin Towers collapsing, and the massive dust cloud, and all everything that happened like there, yeah. And all the terrorist bombings are foreshadowing of it too. Unexpectedly, kaboom, disaster, dust everywhere, destruction everywhere, just surprise, big surprise. All this stuff's like surprise, surprise, surprise. Yeah, we just shrug our solar says nothing's a surprise. Anyone says surprise, just willfully, they're ignoring the mind. They're trying to willfully insist that it be a surprise for them. Playing dumb, playing like they're spiritually demented. But they're not. It's a pretense, actually. No one's spirit is sick. No one's spirit is crazy or demented. Not at all. It's all a pretense. It's a pretending. So nobody needs to be healed from dementia. Actually, it's pretending. It's all pretense. The more we take it as real and try to fix it, the deeper into delusion we go. It's just 100% pretense. Spirit is perfect as God created it. It will always be perfect. There's nothing ever wrong with spirit. Could never be anything wrong. There's nothing to fix. We're just playing this silly game and pretending that, there's a way to make it all work. Which there isn't. We cannot change our will, the will of God, reality. We can't change what we are. Not at all. How are we doing here? We're pretty good for the chilliness of the evening here. Wow. Got down to 30 last night here. A lot of ice and a lot of freezing, but most people think, that's not so bad, 30. Well, it is for us here. It's pretty cold. But no wind, so it wasn't so bad. It's the wind that makes it bad. Speaking of the wind, the asteroid coming in will create a huge wind tsunami, as it were. Yeah, wow. I mean, it's just the very stuff that happens is not good. It's not good. The atmosphere, the push of the atmosphere is just intense. It's bad news all the way around. So if we can become aware this is not what we really want, it can ultimately be stopped. I don't know how plausible that is, actually. But, hey, the people of Nineveh repented. Jonah has warned them. They repented. Jonah, 3 days in the belly of the whale, all darkness, as it refers to this asteroid and the cloud of massive cloud of darkness that kicks up and causing, us to feel like the light is gone. The light is gone. All light is gone. And we think that this will have a deep, deep alchemical effect on our spirit to turn us away from the light forever. This is what the ego are hoping for. And certainly it'll traumatize them, and it certainly will delay, cause a dramatic delay to some extent. But that can all be walked back. Especially if you have the right attitude of just, just business as usual, don't worry about it. That's what's great about Jesus and these teachers, great teachers, is this, even something like this doesn't rattle them in the slightest bit. They just bought off a duck's back. Say, sure, business as usual. We'll walk that back, no problem. And this is just, this is how it goes. Because they see exactly what it's all about. They know it's all a pretense, a delay, distraction, doesn't work. Holy Spirit, vision of light is there. Everything's fine. You just have to walk it back and say, okay, that was didn't get me anywhere. So let's just not do that anymore. And let's, work on evaporating the continuity fear and everything. Everything's going to end. As Ramana Maharshi said, it all ends perfectly. Don't worry. They say, how's it going to turn out? Romani says, don't worry. It all ends perfectly. This is what they see, because it's true. They don't get rattled by this, which is a big help for all of us. Now, the videos with the graphics and the lights, in no way is this depicting the vision of light. It's just a crude metaphor, so to speak. And yet, if you put something into it, you'll get something out of it. This is what I found. You can just sort of look at it and say, what's supposed to, as if it's speaking to the intellect or the ego. There's nothing there for the intellect of the ego, actually. There's nothing really there. But if you say, let this be, speak to my spirit as to infer something to me. What is this plausibly inferring? Use your imagination, use your spirit to say, ah, I'm getting this sense of plausible inference from this, of something way better than this, and yet this is sort of like a little catalyst to help me plausibly infer. Okay, well, lifeline. Lifeline is some sort of help is coming. I know it is. And so we thank the Holy Spirit for the help we are about to receive. And keep your good habits going right now. I'm certainly doing that. It's never that easy, but I'm trying to keep stretching and keep the right food going good. I'm going to try, I don't know, what I'll maybe try to do a kale smoothie tonight. Oh my gosh, maybe a drink some kale tonight. Maybe I will. I had a wild green salad last night with collard greens and turnip greens and mustard greens and, I don't know, radish greens, all these greens, you know. It's like poke salad Annie. You know, poke salad Annie, or they call it poke salad Annie. Picking all these greens for, you know, salad. They go out and just pick all these weeds, sort of. But they're actually very nutritious, very nutritious. I don't know, it might make me turn green, as possible, but... anyway, it's very good, it's very good. Very, very good. Just throw in some pine nuts and feta cheese and some sweet red onions and some nice balsamic vinegar and, oil, some olive oil, and you're good to go. So have fun. It's fun to dabble in this health, healthy food, sweet, tart cherry juice. Got some of that today. Pomegranate juice, tart cherry juice, supposed to help recover your achy muscles and stuff. I hope so, because my muscles get very achy, body pain from working out. When you get older, just your muscles don't bounce back. You can overdo it, and then you feel worn down. So I'm trying to eat, more protein and stuff that's supposed to help the body recover. And I hope it does. I've got to be very careful about that. After you exercise a lot, you need to eat some recovery food. They say eggs are good, protein drinks, salmon, eggs, protein drink, whey, soy lettuce, and protein from that source, tart red cherry juice, pomegranate juice, I tend to not eat anything after I worked out or something strenuous, but that's not a good idea, actually. They say, actually, 30 minutes after you really have put in vigorous exercise, you need to help the body recover from it, or else it starts breaking down the muscle, which is true. It starts breaking down the muscle. But if you give it food quickly, it'll go after the food instead of starting to break down the muscle. So I'm going to try and take that to heart. Oh, Greek yogurt's another thing they said, yeah. Eggs, Greek yogurt, protein drinks, salmon, and blueberries, pomegranate juice, tart cherry juice, tart red cherry juice, and And any berries are supposed to be very helpful. So I keep eating a lot of blueberries. So this is all, I mean, it's just a nice little fun. Have fun with the spiritual path. Get a good chuckle out of it. And it's probably a little bit helpful. It might be. Well, okay, very great. We reached the 1 hour mark. That's enough with this cold. I'm not going to be a martyr to the cold. So stay upbeat here. We don't get downcast, or we don't allow any of that stuff to happen. We say, okay, you know, something is developing here, and we're getting more and more clarity here, and this is a very positive thing. And we will continue with this. All right, very great. That's it for this one.